Good morning. Oh, we didn't test the mics this morning. Oh, dear. Okay. So let's try that again. Good morning. Welcome to Rosewood Church, those of you who are on time. Welcome to those of you viewing online. My name is Bonny Mulder-Behnia, one of our pastors here, and Pastor Fernando is leading the Spanish service as we speak. We are in a relatively short season of exploring the Psalms, those songs and poems written thousands of years ago that still express the human emotions so well. In our sermon today in the English service, we will be diving into Psalm 145. Pastor Fernando is leading the Spanish worshipers through Psalm 71, and they really have similar themes. So I want to call us to worship with part of Psalm 71. And here it says, "As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you, God, more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long, though I know not how to relate them all. I will come and proclaim your mighty acts, Sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteous deeds, yours alone. Since my youth, God, you have taught me, and to this day I declare your marvelous deeds. Even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come." Today in our service, a little later, we're going to give you a chance during sharing time to share about your experience of God's goodness. So as we sing, as we worship, be thinking about something you might want to share so that the next generation and all who are here we'll be able to hear that. So let's stand this morning to sing God's praises.
God, you reign forever and ever. God, you reign. The Lord reigns on high. It is so good to sing his praises. Let's sing another. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil while we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power. In us, we seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives for your atoning prize. To see the captives' hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. Church, we pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets, and then set your church on fire with the nations back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty change. You made us for much more than this. Awake, a kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. We are your church. We are the hope of the world. Build your kingdom here. Let the It's a great, great day to rejoice in the Lord. We're going to sing of that now. This is the day. One, two, three. Let's sing together. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad. the sun will shine, whether the skies will rain, I know that you are good, and this is the day you made. Whether in life or death, whether in joy or pain, I know the truth remains, that this is the day you made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift His name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad. Now I can walk in faith, you will protect my way. Your every work is good, and this is the day you made. I am a child of yours, you are the one who saves. I am redeemed by now, and this is the day you made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift His name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad. This is the day, come and sing your praise, for the Lord now reigns. On the throne of grace, soon is the day He will bring us home, and we have this hope, for we are His own. This is the day, come and sing your praise, for the Lord now reigns on the throne of grace. Soon is the day He will bring us home, and we have this hope, for we are His own. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift His name. This is the day that the Lord. Rejoice and be glad. And this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift His name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad.
Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we come to you on this cloudy, rainy, cool day, and we still bring you our praise, Lord. We thank you that on good days and bad days and every day, Lord, that this is your day and that we belong to you. And Lord, we want to give you our all. We want to give you our praise. We want to bring you our joys, our sorrows. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you in any situation and that you are always good and you are always here with us to hear us and to have compassion and love for us. So this morning, Lord, we rejoice in who you are. We rejoice that we can be together and we rejoice in your love. All this we pray in Jesus' name, amen. I want to welcome you all here this morning. So glad that you're here. Children, we're going to keep you with us again for a while. I love to keep you here. I just hate to see you go. And we're going to mingle. We're going to bless someone, welcome someone to Rosewood this morning.
You like that? I think it's good. the mic on this Sunday. Good morning, my Rosewood Church family. As you make your way to your seats, I'm going to ask the deacons or those who were asked to do take offering today to come forward. I just thank God so much that he gives us this opportunity to be a part of this act of worship. Our offerings and our tithes support the ministries of Rosewood and agencies and missionaries around the world. And there are many ways to give. You can give as the plates are being passed around, online, Venmo, write a check, come to the office during the week, any way you can. But we just thank you so much. Let's pray right now and ask God to bless these offerings. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this opportunity to make a difference in our church and our community, Lord. Lord, help us to be generous givers, both with our money and with our lives, dear Lord. We know that all good gifts come from you. And from these riches, we bring these offerings. Lord, we ask you to help us to use it for the purpose, for your purpose in this place, dear Lord, and for the benefit of those in need. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, as the offering plates are being passed around, we ask that you go to the center aisle. There should be a black friendship folder. We would like for someone close to the middle to get those friendship folders. And please let us know if you are here today. Please write your name in the front of the friendship folder. And then on the back of the friendship folder, we ask that you let us know if you have any prayer requests. We have a group of people who pray weekly for our church and our loved ones. And so we just want to know if you need prayer, if you know anyone who needs prayer. Next Saturday, in Loving Sympathy, we will have the memorial service for Miss Sadie Nagin. It will be Saturday, February the 10th at 11 a.m. I know someone called and asked if it was yesterday, and I was like, no, it's February the 10th. It's going to be here at Rosewood Church, and we just want you to keep the Nagin family in your thoughts and your prayers this week as they prepare for next Saturday. Some of our upcoming events next Sunday, February the 11th, right before, we're going to have a Valentine's bake sale. The gyms are going to have their Valentine bake sale next Sunday, February the 11th, right after worship service. If it rains, we're still going to have it rain or shine. We need bakers big time. I've had a couple of people call, but we need bakers to make special treats, and we need those that have sweet tooths to come and with some cash and support the gym's girls, because all the money that we receive will be helping the gyms and moms camp that we're going to this May. So, yes, come hungry next Sunday. And also next Sunday, we want you to start preparing your hearts this week for our communion service that we're having next Sunday, February the 11th. Prepare your hearts for this holy meal in which we remember Christ's sacrifice for us and receive anew the assurance of our forgiveness. Sunday, February the 18th, we're having a newcomer's lunch. After our morning service. For anyone who has just started attending regularly and recently, and you might want a chance to meet the whole staff and get to know us, we would love for you to come join us February the 18th for a newcomer's lunch, and it's free and there's no obligation. We just want you to meet us. If you are a guest today, we ask that you stop by the welcome desk and receive a free gift from us. Again, no strings attached. We just want to say thank you so much for coming and being with us today. And today, looks nice, but we never know. It might just rain. We're going to go ahead and have coffee in A6 and 7 So those who are designated to get the coffee, let's just go ahead and do it in A6 and 7 because they say it was going to rain. And if you have your phone on, we ask that you put it on silent right now. And I'm going to call up Pastor Bonny.
We're going to, this is the reason we kept the children here, is that we would like to have a little bit of a sharing time. So if you read ahead to Psalm 145, you can see that I'm in the wrong place for the mics, but anyway, you can see that it's about sharing, proclaiming God's goodness to the next generation and to all who will hear. And so what I'd like to do is just to give you an opportunity just to share briefly an example of how God has been good to you, or how you have seen God's goodness in your life, or maybe in the life of someone else. Not a long story, just some brief snippets of God's goodness that you think others might be blessed to hear. So who wants to go first? Okay, good. Thank you, Rob.
Evidence of God's goodness is this row right here. And in other churches across the country, other children sitting, worshiping God.
And children, you may share too if you have, if you want to say something good about God. Okay.
I've just learned to wait on God's timing. It just seems like God always is there, and I think he shows up, but he's always there. And then I just recognize it. Mm-hmm. And as I've got older, that is something I just see over and over again.
All right. Thank you. Others? Nella. Okay, let's see. Maybe we can pass it down to her. How's that?
Okay. I was blessed with a birthday, 92 years, and God has been so good to me.
Amen.
And I love my church here. And I come as often as I can.
All right.
Thanks to Larry and Clara, they're so grateful. I'm so grateful to them because they picked me up, and so it's all good.
Amen. Amen. And Clara's next.
Okay, I just had cataract surgery and a new lens put in, but then I still couldn't see well, and I just got my new glasses. And I'm so glad, because next week I got to take my DMV test, and you know I
got to see. Amen. It's the little things sometimes. All right, Joy.
I don't want to cry. I'm thankful for saints like Sadie and Linda Vander Ark that led the way for us and showed God's love.
Amen. And I'm thankful to Joy and her team that they bless families in their time of sorrow, provide lunch at their memorial services. That's just such a beautiful blessing.
Last week, I went to the doctor, and I'm now in remission because I'd had cancer 5 years ago. And but what I wanted to share is the fact that this was my second cancer. And but my grandmother used to say, you cannot get stuck along the road. You have to keep moving, even if you have to call AAA sometimes. But our AAA is always our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And I thank him for the healing over my body. Mm-hmm. I thank him for continually keeping my family and throwing all these miracles in our way.
Amen. God's always on call. Amen. Sandy.
I'm thankful for God being by my side when I had endometrial cancer last year. And I'm so thankful and praise him so much for being by my side the whole time.
Amen. We're so glad you're here. Well, I'm back here. Okay, Tony.
I want everyone to say, God is faithful.
God is faithful.
There's a new song, I know you probably heard it, by Toby Mac. It says, as my world broke into pieces, you were there faithfully. Hmm. As I cried unto you, you were there faithfully. I may never be the same man again, but I'm still a man that believes. Over 14 years ago, on a rainy day, I found myself sleeping in a car because I thought I was better than the banks. I'm not going to pay my mortgage. And guess what? When you don't pay your mortgage, they will come and foreclose. Remember that. And I lost everything. And as the rain was coming down on my car, I said, Lord, if you ever restore me, everything that you bless me with will be tagged with glory to you. Hmm. He's blessed us with a trucking company, which my better half is not here. Keep her in prayer. She's here in spirit. Hmm. She's got a back pain, knee pain, shoulder pain, you name it. She always says, Lord, can you test someone else? I've been getting tested too many times. Is there other sisters that might want to be tested? She always tells me, I said, look, he's giving you the strength to endure through everything. So keep her in prayer. Her name is Anna. That's my better half. And she took a chance on me. When everybody say, he's homeless, he has nothing, why are you taking a chance with him? And guess what? God sent her to me. And because of that, because God is faithful and he will put your world back together if you only admit to your downfalls. But if you come to him saying, why me? Instead of saying, forgive me for being disobedient to you, he will restore everything. And today I can say, I have a wife that loves the Lord, 18 grandkids. I thought I was Job. I lost everything. Now he blessed me with 18 grandkids. His business, which is called Trucking for Jesus, and we love joyriding, even in the rain. And I thank everyone, and I thank one person right now that deserves to be thanked, Pastor Bonny, because she has shown me how God is faithful. When her world broke into pieces last year of the loss of her son, guess what? God was there faithfully. And she could have said, you know what, don't call me until I'm ready. But guess what? 2 or 3 weeks later, she was back there giving us the word of God. So I thank you, Pastor Bonny. You've been an inspiration to me.
Thank you.
Well, I just thank God Almighty that he's been there for me. I've had really rough times almost my whole life, but because of God, I can deal and I can live through it because God is good. And I just love the Lord, my God, with all my soul and all my might. Just, I thank the Lord for everything he gives me, for without him, I'd be nothing. Mm. I'd be in a ditch. Mm. So thank you, Lord Jesus, for everything.
Mm. Amen. Pam, should bring it there.
I usually don't do this. I'm so thankful that in May I could have my brain surgery, and so thankful that in November our son-in-law got a new heart.
Amen. Amen. Okay.
My wife and I are very thankful that we have two grandkids, not 18 like Tony, but we're thankful for the two boys, but we really wanted a granddaughter too. Our son and daughter-in-law, they said they weren't gonna have kids at least for a long time and maybe never. And they did everything possible not to, almost, but we are looking forward to having a granddaughter in June.
Amen. Okay. Okay, precious. Get my steps in. Here you go.
I thank God on Thanksgiving Day, I was called and told that all my 6 kids were sick, including all their keepers. Everybody in the house was sick. I prayed to God, I cried, I did everything I could. Before the end of the Thanksgiving Day, I received the news that two of them passed away. Hmm. But I'm grateful to God because he saved the life of the rest. It would have been the worst case scenario. So I thank God for that.
Hmm. Wow. I'm going to give a last call if any children want to say something good about God. Any children want to say something that you know good about God? Because you could teach us. Anyone? All right. Okay, well, they're nervous this morning until they get to Promised Land. All right, let's say a word of prayer. God, you are so good. Lord, thank you for the testimonies of your faithful people, Lord, who talk about going through devastating times and yet looking to you, and you provided and you give them grace and comfort and mercy and healing. And Lord, we thank you for this family that you put together, Lord, that we can encourage one another with stories of you, and we can testify to your goodness in our lives. Lord, we pray for our children who are hearing this. Lord, we pray that they will have stories to tell of you, Lord, as they grow up here, and that we may all learn from each other, one generation to the next, but also the younger generation back up to us. And Lord, we just thank you that we can all be one together and learn from one another. And Lord, that you are such a faithful and gracious God. All this we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so now it's time for children, if you want to come on up. You had lots of time to get ready to run. Yeah, okay. So congregation, if you could raise your hand and we're going to bless you. The Lord be with you. Okay. And Brad's going to lead us in a new song.
Well, we have so much to be thankful for. And this song is a song of thanks, and it is called Gratitude. One, two, three, four, five, six. All my words fall short. I got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
got one response. I've got just one hope. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for the king except for a heart singing. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
One more time.
Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of your lungs. My soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great. Oh, Lord, my God,
Praise God. He is so good. Amen. You may be seated. That's the theme of our message this morning about praising God. We're continuing the sermon series, Praying the Psalms. And the title this morning is, We Just Can't Keep It In, right? So we're going to read Psalm 145. It's on page 898 in the book, in the Bible in your chair racks. Otherwise, you can follow along on the screen. Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name. Forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome deeds. And I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all he does. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and faithful in all he does. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever and ever. Amen. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Do you ever come to church on a Sunday morning and say to yourself, I don't feel like praising this morning? Right? Brad and the band start leading in a song like, How Can I Keep From Singing Your Praise? Or There's Joy in the House of the Lord. Or This Is the Day That the Lord Has Made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. But you, on this particular day maybe, just feel like folding your arms and refusing to sing. Or maybe tears start welling up in your eyes as you think about the tough week you've had, or the discord at home, or the sickness you or a loved one have been experiencing. And you think, how could God even expect me to be joyful knowing what I'm going through? I think God would give me a pass on praise today. Not so fast. There's a saying that goes like this: sometimes you have to act your way into a feeling rather than feel your way into an action, right? Let me say that again. You have to act your way into a feeling rather than feel your way into an action. You may have to force yourself to start praising even when your soul is protesting. And then you will likely discover that the act of praising God begins to change your feeling and your attitude and your mood. Your circumstance will still be the same, at least temporarily, but your perspective gets a lift as you focus on our great God. I read a story this week about a pastor named Andrew Brunson, who was sent as a missionary to Turkey, where he and his wife served for 23 years, planting churches, helping refugees, and training Christian leaders, until 2016, when he was falsely accused of terrorism and sent to prison for 2 long years. Now, since he was released, he wrote a book called God's Hostage. And in it, he shares the profound feelings of abandonment and brokenness he felt in prison. He was even concerned that he might be losing his mind. So he made a determination to praise God and even to dance, because Jesus commanded us to rejoice and be exceedingly glad when you are persecuted. Pastor Brunson decided to obey Christ and do it as a discipline, he said, not out of any feelings, because he admitted, I didn't feel any happiness or any joy. This was merely a matter of obeying the words of Jesus. So he said, I began every day to set aside 5 minutes, and I would start out by saying to God, I repent that I have not been joyful. Now I am going to perform an act of joy. I am going to be glad before you in spite of these terrible circumstances. I am separated from my wife and my children. I don't know what's going to happen to me or to them, and I am isolated and in prison. But I am going to rejoice. He said, and then I would begin to dance, and I would hop around, and I would leap. I would dance before God every day as a discipline. And then I would say, rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven. This sounds a bit like the Apostle Paul and Silas. Remember, they were in jail also. They were praying and singing hymns to God with their feet held in stocks, completely chained up. I wonder if they were singing Psalm 145, which is one of the most famous psalms of praise. The words of this psalm lift us out of any situation and usher us into the presence of God, where the problems of life fade away, even temporarily, as we consider the big story of the whole world. King David begins and ends this psalm by praising God directly. Verse 1, I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. David's words sound like a love song to God, right? He is exuberant in praise. You can almost see him leaping around for joy like Pastor Brunson did. Now, actually, David did dance before the Lord with all his might, it says in the Bible, when he was able to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. In fact, he stripped down to the bare necessities as he danced in public, much to his wife's disapproval. Now, David was a pretty dramatic guy, but sometimes that's what we need to get us out of our half-hearted, lukewarm stance before God. He says, I will exalt you, I will praise you, I will extol your name, which means enthusiastic praise. He's finding every synonym for praise at increasing levels. Now, Psalm 145 is actually a poem of praise that we call an acrostic, okay? So if you don't know what an acrostic is, I'm going to explain it. But in this psalm, every verse begins with a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And I was looking in my Hebrew Bible yesterday. It really is cool to see all the lines with a letter of the Hebrew alphabet in front of it. So, an example of an acrostic we sometimes use here at Rosewood is ACTS, okay? It stands for Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, Supplication. This is a suggested pattern for prayer, okay? In prayer, we come to God in adoration, we confess our sins, we thank him for his goodness, and we bring our supplications, our requests before him. Another more familiar acrostic example is GEMS, which you saw for a moment. It stands for Girls Everywhere Meeting the Savior. Okay, I always get bugged by that little the, like it just doesn't, it's not a true acrostic, but okay. GEMS means Girls Everywhere Meeting the Savior, okay. So it's like this is what David did. He wrote out all the letters of the alphabet and he came up with something good about God for each one. Now this is the only one of the Psalms of David that is all positive, all praise. Right, there are plenty of other psalms out of the 150 in which David and other writers cry out to God because they feel abandoned or attacked or like God is not listening to them. But in this poem, David is seemingly doing a flyover of history, like a drone's overview, and he's concluding with confidence that God is worthy of his most passionate praise every single day of his life, forever and ever. Now, when God created the world, at various interludes, it says at the end of each day, but to God, a day could be as 1,000 years. So at various interludes in creation, God stepped back, looked around and said, "Ah, yes, this is good." Maybe some of you have had that feeling after you created a piece of art or made a project or written a paper or washed and shined up your car or your house, decorated a cake, dressed up in your best clothes for a special occasion, and you step back and you say, "Ah, yes, this is good," right? This is how I think of Psalm 145. The psalmist is looking back over his life and even further back, all that he knows of the story of God from creation on, and he gets a big smile and he says, "Ah, yes, God is so very good." So then he makes this commitment in preparation for eternity, where we will literally praise God forever and ever. David says he will praise God every single day while here on earth, which is what we are invited to do as we prepare for eternity, right? Live into our future. Now, most of us are creatures of habit for the most part. Every morning we get up and we have some kind of routine, right? If you're a parent of young children, that routine involves getting everyone up and dressed and fed and off to school or whatever you do for the day. If you're an empty nester like me, it just means crawling to the kitchen and making a cup of coffee before even talking to God or any living creature, right? Some of us are not morning people. I'm guessing King David was. He could have been quite annoying in the morning. But notice, he doesn't say here, morning. He just says, "Every day I will praise you." It could be morning, noon, or night, or all of the above. The point is for us to praise daily, no matter what we are going through, regardless of our circumstances, every single day, that this would be the highest priority on our long to-do list. Now, David concludes this psalm the same way he began it, with praising God. Verse 21, he says, "My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever and ever." It's like he's saying, "I just can't keep it in. My mouth will keep on speaking of God, as will every creature for all eternity." You may remember Jesus once said that if his disciples were prevented from praising, the stones would cry out instead. And you may recall the words of the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Philippians. He said in Philippians 2:9, "At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Acknowledging and praising God every day, I think, especially first thing in the morning and last thing at night, because it puts a godly perspective on everything that happens in between. This way, our praise is not dependent on whether things went our way, but rather it helps us to consider God's character, who God was, is, and is to come, because God never changes. We praise God, first of all, because of who God is. And in this psalm, we read of many of God's attributes. David names God's greatness in verse 3, his grace, goodness, and compassion in verses 8 and 9, his glory and might in verse 11, his righteousness and kindness in verse 17, and his providential care in verse 20. Who could not praise a God with these wonderful characteristics? It seems that verse 8 kind of sums it all up, where he says, the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. There was a controversy among theologians of the early Christian church. It was called Marcionism. And this happened like in the year 144, if you can imagine the year 144. And this was determined to be a heresy. And this heresy claimed that the God of the Old Testament was a different God than the God of the New Testament. And the proponent of this theory claimed that the Old Testament God was angry and vengeful and did a lot of killing and wiping out people, like in the flood, and sending people to war. And he claimed that in contrast, God, the Father of Jesus, portrayed in the New Testament, was more loving and gentle and compassionate and full of grace and mercy. Now, you can kind of see where he got that idea from the stories we know, but we also know, as the Bible says, that God is the same always, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And David is writing this psalm in Old Testament times, describing the God he has come to know. This God is gracious, in that he does not treat us harshly as our sins deserve, but removes them as far as the east is from the west. God is compassionate in that he saw us as sheep without a shepherd in need of a savior. And it says that God is slow to anger. Not that he never gets angry. We saw some of that anger, especially in the Old Testament. But God has a long fuse, so to speak, right? There's explosives at the end of the rope, but through Jesus, the sparks are snuffed out before they reach the point of destruction. Now, David uses the Hebrew term gadol chesed for God. Now, I want you to say the word chesed with me, okay? Because it's not chesed, right? It's gadol chesed, and maybe we can see that on the screen. Okay, gadol chesed, and that is meaning rich in love. That's how it's translated. But it could also be translated as abounding in love or great loving kindness. The word chesed is so full of meaning. It includes love and grace and mercy and kindness. We see signs of God's gadol chesed already in the Garden of Eden, after people had sinned, when he hinted at a savior who would crush the serpent's head. We see signs of God's gadol chesed after the flood, when God said, "Never again will I wipe out the world in this way." It was God's abounding, gracious love that caused him to send Jesus to take the punishment for our sin so that we would never have to experience the fullness of God's anger. Here's what one commentator wrote. He said, "When Jesus cries out from the cross, 'It is accomplished,' or 'It is finished,' it was in a way a cry that descended directly from Psalm 145's declaration that this is a God of gadol chesed, of great loving kindness or utter grace. How great? The crucified Savior's lifeless body impaled on a spit of wood is the answer. God's gracious compassion is that great." The psalmist then goes on to name the many ways in which God demonstrates his abounding love for us, how he lifts up those who are bowed down, how he provides food for the hungry, how he comes near to all those who call on him, how he hears the cries of his people and saves them, how he watches over his people. He ultimately never fails us, and his motivation is love. Our response is to praise him and to share the good news of God with all. In this psalm, as in scripture, we read repeatedly about the importance of sharing the good news of God with the next generation. The psalmist says in verse 4, "One generation commends your work to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. They tell of the power of your awesome works. And I will proclaim your great deeds." So one generation passes down the story of God, their testimony of their own experience of God, to the next. They tell, they speak, they proclaim. The story of creation, all the stories of the Old Testament, were passed down orally, verbally, before they were ever recorded in scrolls and before they ever made it into our Bibles. And think about how you learned them. Most of the stories in Scripture we remember as being told to us as children, maybe in Sunday school or from our parents, or maybe as adults you heard someone tell them. We didn't just sit down and discover them all by reading. How do stories of your family get passed down? Often when a family member passes away, their life story is then pieced together and written down, and stories are shared at the memorial service and leading up to it and after it. But as the generations go by, the stories fade. Think of this. Those of us who lived when 9/11 happened can tell stories of where we were and what we were doing, and we recall watching our TV screens in horror. But that story, too, will be buried in history books as the generations pass. Even the stories of this church. You know, there are a few historians still around who can give eyewitness accounts. But many of our teens and our children have no idea that the founders of this church came here during the middle of the night to lay the foundation because there was a union picket line in front of church during the day. Right? That's a story, that's part of our history that we tell to each other, but it's not written in a book. One theologian made this bold statement. He said, "Whether we admit it or not, every local church is one generation short of extinction." That's kind of scary. And it's not just the job of parents and pastors to nurture the faith of our children and teens and young adults and those new to the faith. This is the role of our whole church family, of every follower of Jesus, to share your personal experiences of God, like we did briefly this morning. How God has been faithful to you through the ups and downs of life. It's all of our responsibility also to tithe to God's church faithfully so that the church may continue to be a lighthouse on this corner of Rose and Woodruff, a place of worship and learning and loving and growing in grace together. The teaching, the mentoring, the finances, it takes all of us partnering together to keep the church going and growing strong. The psalmist challenges all of us. In verse 10, "Your faithful people extol you," praise you. "They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might so that all people may know of your mighty acts." So here's the big picture in this psalm. God is so unfathomably great and so awesome and so faithful that we just can't keep it in. We sing and pray and even shout God's praises, and then we share the good news of Jesus and his salvation with all people, with everyone we know. We don't just share it with words, we share it through our lifestyle and our attitudes and our words and our actions and our worship and our commitment to God's church and God's people and our generous heart for those who are struggling or suffering or lost. To sum it up, here are three practical practices for living into this psalm in the coming week and beyond. The first, I already said it, praise God every day. Start out with praise in the morning. Maybe do a 5-minute dance like the imprisoned pastor or the gleeful King David. Or maybe sing a praise song. Maybe just list the ways you see God at work in the world and in your life. And end each day with a thank you to God. If it's been a rough day, thank him that it's over. Or thank him for a nice warm bed or for a person in your life whom you love. Right? Praise God every day. 2, consider God's rich love and ask God to grow in you that same love for others. Because if we have gadol chesed, great loving kindness, we will be people of peace who avoid words and actions that cause hurt and avoid anything that grieves the heart of God. Instead, we will help those in need. We will forgive others, even if they never ask. We will encourage those who are down. We will serve as ambassadors of God's great love because of what God has done for us. And third, excuse me, tell somebody about God. Who needs to know that God will never let go of them? Who needs to know that God loves them even in their brokenness and in their suffering? Who in your life doesn't yet know Jesus? Think about how you can share your faith with the next generation, either personally or supporting a ministry that does. May your love for God overflow in love for others to the level that you just can't help but tell somebody about his goodness. Again, this week, I'm going to encourage you to read the psalm every day. Read through Psalm 145. This could be the start of your daily praise routine, if dancing or shouting is not your style. Praise God in whatever way you choose, how the Spirit leads you. Just remember to act your way into a feeling until it becomes as natural as breathing. Where you're breathing, I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Let's pray. God, we praise your name today, and we want to praise your name every day. Lord, may your Spirit move in us. May you give us eyes to see your goodness all around us. Lord, even when things feel dark, even when things feel stormy, we pray that you will help us to praise anyway, that you will help us to rise above the circumstances of this life and live into your promises for eternity, Lord. Make us people of praise, faithful people of praise, who not only speak it to you, Lord, but speak it to others. Lord, give us such a passion for you that we can't help but share it. Lord, we pray that people may be able to see you living in us and hear you when we speak, even when we're not speaking about you, that we may reflect the Lord living in us. Thank you for this psalm of praise, Lord. Thank you for this reminder of how great you are and how loving you are. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you for our closing song of praise.
Mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's all sing that together. I love you, Lord. Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness. Led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I know you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I will sing of the goodness of God. My life, you have been faithful.
Amen. Praise God. He is good. Amen. Invite you to stay for coffee. It will be through these double doors here in room A6 and 7 just to keep us warm. And invite you to cup your hands to receive God's blessing for you today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his loving gaze toward you and give you his peace. Amen. Go in his peace.